have a huge passion for it now, so I'm excited just to share that with you all tonight, and I appreciate, again, the invitation to be here. So I want to start with, and I apologize, I have to jump out of my presentation, but just the National Association of Manufacturers is a nationwide organization, so on a very small scale in the Chattanooga region, we support and advocate for manufacturing, but they're the nationwide spokesperson for manufacturers. So just a really short video to kind of open up with, just give you a sense of manufacturing in 2018.
For 2 weeks, we're going to be crisscrossing the country, sharing the story of modern manufacturing. We're going to go to 35 different events, and the focus is inspiring the next generation of the manufacturing workforce. Because the future of the industry, and indeed the future of America, depend on it.
The wind shifted back to manufacturers starting last summer.
The reality is great things are ahead of us. We will engineer and manufacture things like no one else in North America. A tremendous opportunity ahead of us.
Global economies are starting to rebound, and they're rebounding in unison.
Manufacturing is front and center. And more importantly, manufacturing workers are front and center.
It's not about white collar or blue collar jobs. It's about new collar jobs. Right now, across manufacturing is probably where 350,000 jobs needed.
We need to be attracting students as early as 5th and 6th grade so that they're aware, so they're picking the right electives and they're headed in the right directions. But we need to make sure those skills align and they match so that institutions are putting out workers that companies need.
Innovation and automation are expanding what American workers can do. Manufacturers are making life-saving medicines. Life-changing technologies. They're revolutionizing food production to feed an ever-growing world. They're making our societies more sustainable and transforming the way we commute and communicate.
When we're talking about modern manufacturing, we're talking about technology and robotics and artificial intelligence and augmented reality.
Right.
You have to have skills in those areas. Our job is to get education and government and business all working together to make sure we have folks with those right skills.
We're growing, we're investing, we're hiring, and we're raising standards of living in communities all across our nation.
We have a chance to rebuild an infrastructure. We have a chance to rebuild manufacturing unlike we've seen in a long, long time.
We give people work that provides meaning and purpose, that offers not just a paycheck, but the satisfaction of having created something that matters. Ultimately, the goal of manufacturing in America is to improve the human condition, and we need everybody to be focused on the success of manufacturers in America.
Manufacturing is a very evolving field, and there's just a lot of exciting different things going on. So just to start and give you an overview, to tell you a little bit about what we do as an association, what my role is in manufacturing, I'm going to go through just some things that we do on a day-to-day basis and how we as the Chattanooga Regional Manufacturers Association support manufacturing and advocate for manufacturing. Our mission statement alone says that we work to enable cooperation, competitiveness, and profitable growth. And regardless of what industry you're in, whether education, healthcare, manufacturing, at the end of the day, we all want to be competitive in order to progress in business. So that's really important. And so whatever I can do and whatever we can do as an association to support industry and those three things, that encompasses everything we do. So I'll give you just a little bit of background on the Chattanooga Manufacturers Association. Was actually established in 1902 and is the first manufacturers association in the country, and I think that speaks highly to just our rich manufacturing culture here. The industry that we have today is completely different from then. We were heavy in foundries, we were heavy in textiles, cars were being started to be manufacturing and into the 1920s, parts for those automobiles were highly manufactured here, and so that was a huge industry. And we don't have to go too far back, where every 4 in 10 jobs in Chattanooga and the Chattanooga region were in manufacturing just several decades ago. But we have seen a shift, and prior to the recession in 2008, at this point in time, we only have about a third of those jobs in those industries still in the Chattanooga region, but have seen significant growth since the end of the recession in 2009. So manufacturing, as you saw in the video, is definitely on the upshift and of just exciting changes, most of that due to an increase in technology, and an increase in doing business here in the United States, and Chattanooga is a hub for that. So in 2010, the Chattanooga Manufacturers Association decided to take a regional approach and became the Chattanooga Regional Manufacturers Association. So we now reach into up to Bradley County, McMahon County. We have membership in Marion County, so surrounding counties of Hamilton County, and then also into North Georgia. As many of you probably know, it's a huge carpeting industry, so manufacturing is very prominent there. So that's kind of our footprint in terms of the region that we support. Our goal is just to advocate and offer support for existing industry, but also incoming industry. So we have our local chamber of commerce do a great job in terms of economic development, and so we just want to serve to be a resource for any incoming industry and advocate for them as well. In 1912, out of the Chattanooga Manufacturers Association, the Tennessee Manufacturers Association was formed in Nashville on the state level. Their primary purpose is to advocate as a voice at the state capitol and also serve as a voice of manufacturing to policymakers on any kind of legislative issues affecting manufacturing. So they serve and represent the entire state of Tennessee. And I want this presentation to be really informal, so if you have any questions as I go through this, feel free to ask any questions. So the majority of our work is done through various committees, and I've listed them all, you can see here. And so I'll just touch on a few things that each of those committees do and the function of those. Those are each have a committee chair, which is usually someone from industry, as well as a vice chair, and then really have diverse committee members that make up the membership. So I'll use our most active committee is environment. We have industry representatives, attorneys, consulting firms that make up that the framework of those committees. That way we're just getting different angles of perspective for a lot of the work we do. And each committee has a mission or a charge, and that's developed by the committee members, not from myself, not from our association, because we really want it to be manufacturing driven. And that just helps it make sure that we're meeting the exact needs of manufacturers. And then most of our events and programs come through the development and the work of all of our committees. Some meet as often as every month, some meet on a quarterly basis. And I'll start with our first one, which is what we call our AIM committee, which is Alliance for Innovation and Manufacturing Excellence. And really the primary purpose of the committee is just to provide networking opportunities for manufacturers, and also gives them an opportunity to meet with consultants, vendors, and get best practice benchmarking opportunities. And then really the focus of that can be anything from lean manufacturing, Six Sigma, sustainability, process improvements. There's usually a lot of topics that range. Talk about supply chain, and we also do plant industry tours, which gives all of our members opportunities to see what other manufacturers are doing. And then I have another video that talks about Manufacturing Day, which is a nationwide event, and I'll just go ahead and show that just to give you an idea of what that is, but this is something that this company is involved in as well.
It's a day celebrating modern manufacturing and the day to inspire the next generation.
Manufacturing Day across the United States.
Celebration of the main manufacturing industry today.
Companies are kicking off events to attract a larger workforce.
Hosting hundreds of high school students today.
At high-tech manufacturing headquarters.
Students considering careers in manufacturing.
Getting first-hand look.
A variety of skills and careers available in manufacturing.
This event is one of 3,000
that the National Association of Manufacturers is coordinating across the United States, where we believe we're going to see about 600,000 students, as well as teachers and community leaders, that are going to be welcomed into our facilities to understand what modern manufacturing is all about.
It makes America strong. It makes America independent. Manufacturers are the lifeblood of our economy.
It's really great to be here at Optical Cable Corporation on National Manufacturing Day, and I really came at the behest of President Trump to honor each of you who work here in manufacturing for being among the 12 million men and women who make things in this country that help to improve our nation, defend our nation, and really just improve everyday life for many Americans.
With different environmental regulations. It used to just be an environmental committee, and because so many companies have such a huge emphasis on safety, we added the safety component to this committee. It's just really neat to see as you go out and tour industry how their number one priority every day and the dangerous environments that they work in is just to make sure that their employees work safe, and the policies and procedures that they've put in place to make sure that happens, but also just the culture that they've created around safety outside of policies and procedures. Industry just takes that really, really seriously, and it's just really neat to see how important that is for them and their employees. We have strong partnerships with the Tennessee Department of Environment and Conservation, Environmental Protection Agency, as well as the Air Pollution Control Bureau, all regulatory agencies that we want our manufacturing partners to have really strong relationships with. And again, give them a seat at the table for any conversations of things that might be affecting manufacturing. Our HR committee is another very active committee, as the world of HR is constantly changing, as many of you may know. We have a breakfast briefing series that's been meeting for the first Wednesday of the month for over 30 years. We bring in a local employment attorney, and they present on topics that are very relevant to HR professionals today, whether that's immigration, contractor employment, employee handbooks, any kind of employee relations practices. It just gives HR professionals, whether you're in manufacturing or not in manufacturing, an opportunity to stay on top of latest changes in that world. We also have a wage and benefit survey, which allows our membership to share data related to wages and benefits and make sure they're staying competitive. And they can compare that across the board to other members, and most of that's anonymous. So we're protecting their information, but also providing them with comparative information. And we do also a lot of member info sharing, which is smaller surveys, but if a member has a question, we can administer a survey. And just an example of some of those are company cell phone policies, attendance policies, 401k matches. Companies that have employee uniforms like to make those comparisons. So just anything that any other company wants to know, that's something that we share with everyone. And the last component of our HR committee is a quarterly leadership series. We usually bring in someone external that comes in once a quarter and provides leadership training to all of our membership. We actually have this one this week. One this week that is talking about millennials in the workforce, because by 2020 it's expected that 46% of all the workforce will be millennials, so everyone's really excited about that one actually. We do time management training, power of habits training, sometimes just different series based on different leadership books, so that's something that most of our members take advantage of as well. We stay on the forefront of any kind of government affairs and community relations issues affecting manufacturing. Like I said, the Tennessee Manufacturers Association was established from the Chattanooga Manufacturers Association, so they really serve as a voice for manufacturers at the state level. If there's an issue going on with one of our members here in Chattanooga, it's a phone call away to them to make sure that they understand the position some of our members want to take, which are sometimes varying positions as well. An example would be, there was a bill not too long ago discussing firearms in the workplace, and we had members on different sides of the fence on that. And so a lot of our members wrote letters that were sent to the Tennessee Manufacturers Association and state representatives just expressing their concerns. So it's really important that we have strong partnerships there that give our members a platform to have those conversations. We have an annual regional mayor's breakfast, which serves the same purpose, to give our membership just a forum set up to ask questions to community mayors, express concerns, just have that influence regionally. And we also do the same thing with state elected officials, state senators, and state representatives have different types of panel events. Getting to the end of all of our committees, tax and finance, which is really a lot of our members that work as in the plants, as plant managers and managers and things like that, don't typically come to a lot of our events, but it's something that definitely has a huge impact on manufacturers, and manufacturers are always thinking about. NAM every year does a manufacturer's outlook survey, and so I have some of the results from the 2017 manufacturer's outlook survey, which just kind of shows the significance that tax reform and legislation plays in the world of manufacturing. 94.6% of manufacturers surveyed currently have a positive economic outlook just based on recent legislation that passed, and overall tax reform, 75% of those supported tax proposals being debated in Congress, and 70% of those also consider a vote against tax reform a vote against their business. So that was just something that was really, really important at the end of last year that manufacturers wanted to really have a voice on, and NAM definitely took the lead on that. As an association here locally, we stay on top of tax bills and legislations via tax attorneys who provide articles and updates to all of our members of things kind of coming down the pipeline that manufacturers should be aware of. And we also just consult with those local attorneys, CPAs, and financial advisors who have expertise and work with manufacturers all the time. And we're actually this year having our first annual tax and finance summit that's geared specifically toward manufacturing, which will provide updates in various realms related to manufacturing. Transportation and logistics is another very important committee. It's the reason why in 1902 the Manufacturers Association here was actually founded, because manufacturers felt like they needed a concerted action, an effort, and to have a voice to get competitive freight rates. So that was the underlying reason of why the Manufacturers Association was established. And here, well over 100 years later, that's still one of the most important things affecting manufacturing, especially here in Tennessee, and even more so in Chattanooga. We have 8 primary interstates across the state of Tennessee, and 76% of the U.S. population is within a day's drive of Tennessee, making it just a very convenient location to do business, and which is also just very attractive to manufacturers. And there's currently 17,000 distribution-related establishments in the state of Tennessee, FedEx and Memphis making up a pretty good part of that, employing 30,000 of the 276 workers that work in transportation and logistics. Here in Chattanooga, we have Covenant Transport, U.S. Express, and Kenco, which are huge suppliers and supporters to manufacturing, and really help with the challenges that manufacturers face, which is transportation, whether it's not having enough truck drivers because there is a huge shortage of those right now, or just the legislation around transportation and the trucking industry. So that's something that I hear as I go out and meet with industry, is how that affects their delivery, their manufacturing a product, but then being able to have the product delivered in a timely manner to their customers is something that's huge. Waterways is something else we have in Tennessee. We have over 1,000 miles of navigable waterways, and it's not the fastest form of transportation, but it is a form of transportation that many manufacturers use. And so we work on legislation and influence that. The Chickamauga Lock is an example of something that manufacturers want rebuilt, so ensuring that there's funding from the federal level to make sure that that project continues is a priority for us as well. And I saved the Education and Workforce Development Committee for last, because as I go out and meet with industry, probably 9 times out of 10, their biggest concern is a skilled and qualified workforce. So we work on various different realms of how can we make sure that if current manufacturers need employees, or if new industry comes to Chattanooga, how can we make sure that they have workers? So partnerships with Chattanooga State and their TCAP program are really, really important. And then as an association, we host Pathways to Prosperity of Southeast Tennessee, which goes down and works in the high school level. One of the current initiatives we are working on as well is with an organization called Hope Street Group. And what they do is they come into an area and they look at current workforce development initiatives and see where they can fill in the gaps. And so one of the gaps we found here is just making sure that industry promote work-based learning, which is anything from an internship, apprenticeship program, just giving students, whether that's at the high school or college level, hands-on experience in a manufacturing environment or whatever the career pathway is. We have advanced manufacturing and then IT are the two pathways that initiative currently focuses on, but just giving them practice outside of the classroom in their working environment. Like I said, we do work with Tennessee College of Applied Technology, or TCAP, and those certifications and programs there are really geared towards manufacturing and have high job placement rates at about 96%, and then also have a 70% completion rate. And then Chattanooga State and TCAP provide about 50,000 hours per year of workforce training to both business and industry across the board, and we work with them all the time just to plug into industry needs and see, you know, how can we better align industry and education. We do work with four-year colleges and universities for things like professional development, continuing education, some graduate programs, and even just for things that manufacturing, just like any other business, needs engineers, HR professionals, supply chain management, accountants, and marketing professionals. So we still try to make sure that those needs are met as well. So now, that was just a really quick overview of the different committees we have and the work we do. And now I'm just gonna kind of shift into the current state of manufacturing across the country, just to give you a comparison of manufacturing in Tennessee, which manufacturing in Tennessee, a lot of the data comes from the National Association of Manufacturers, and aligns pretty much right on track with what I would say is happening here in the Chattanooga region. They just have readily available data, which makes it really easy to show you. So I'll start with that. So most of their data goes back to 2016. But this just says manufacturing contributed $2.25 trillion to the U.S. economy. And also it accounted for 11.7% of the economy's gross domestic product, which has over the past 25 years manufactured goods in the United States have quadrupled. So even though there was a bit of a downturn in manufacturing, there's definitely been an increase in overall manufactured goods that have been made right here in the U.S. And this is for every dollar spent in manufacturing. $1.89 is added to the U.S. economy, which is the highest multiplier effect of any other sector. And for every worker that's hired in manufacturing, or hired elsewhere, and a lot of that is in supply chain, logistics, transportation, and those numbers are growing and are expected to continue to grow. So this is something that definitely aligns with the Chattanooga region for sure. The majority of manufacturing firms in the United States are small, and by small, typically that number is less than 500 employees. So when we think of your McKees and your Volkswagens, you think over, 1,000 employees. But we have about 200 members within our membership here in Chattanooga, with over half of those, I would say, having less than 100 employees. And even as I've been out meeting with industry in the past couple of weeks, companies that are manufacturing a lot of different things had less than 50, less than 25. So a lot are significantly small, as indicated here. There's around 250,000 manufacturing firms in the United States, and all but 3,800 of those had less than 500 employees. And then it was even noted that many of those had less than 20 employees. And what I always find really intriguing too about small manufacturing firms is that their benefits and the things that they're doing in terms of employee retention and employee engagement is right on track with your bigger corporations. I went to a plant this week that had less than 35 employees, and the company was paying 100% of healthcare benefits, which is something that I think we tend to think only larger corporations are doing, but the smaller companies are really taking initiative there as well. $12.5 million is about the total number of manufacturing workers in the United States, and since the end of what we call the Great Recession, which ended in about 2008, manufacturers have one of the highest percentages of workers who are eligible for employer-provided health benefits. The main qualifier to what is eligible in that sense is number of hours worked, so being full-time versus part-time manufacturing. Typically, workers do qualify as full-time, and manufacturers usually hire employees full-time, as well as there's plenty of opportunity for overtime as well. So in 2015, 92% of employees were manufacturing employees were considered eligible for their company's employer provided benefits in terms of health care, and then 84% of those actively participate in their employer's health plans. As I've alluded to, manufacturers have experienced a lot of growth over, I'd say, the past 20 years. Output per hour technically has increased by 2.5% since 1987, and most of that is just attributed strictly to technology and then unit labor costs, while output per hour has increased the unit labor cost. So the cost of manufacturing a specific unit has decreased by about 8.4%. Again, related to technology, and then it's causing a shift not in getting rid of jobs, but also just in the types of jobs that are needed. So while machines and technology are making jobs of manufacturing employees easier, it's also opening up other positions, you know, to transfer employees into other lines of work, and that's also causing a demand for a higher level of skill needed, which I'll get into more in just a minute when I talk about skills gap and workers needed. So if you look at manufacturing as a economy compared to all the economies across the world, it would rank as the ninth largest economy in the world with $2.1 trillion of value added as an overall sector. 2016 was the first year that foreign direct investment in the United States exceeded $1.5 trillion, which is huge. And U.S. affiliates of foreign multinational enterprises employ more than $2 million of manufacturing workers. So countries are investing in doing business here. And 1/6 of the manufacturing sector is operated and ran and owned by foreign companies. And the largest manufacturing sectors with foreign investment are machinery, food, and fabricated metal products. And that's pretty much true for the same thing in Tennessee as well. So research and development, manufacturing is responsible for about 75% of all R&D across the country, and that's seen a significant growth. In 2000, there was about $126 billion were invested in R&D in terms of manufacturing, and in 2014, that had almost doubled to $229 billion of investment, and pharmaceuticals do make up about a third of the R&D in manufacturing. And other sectors where R&D applies to manufacturing is aerospace, chemicals, computers, electronics, and motor vehicles. So now I'll get into just some details and figures here in Tennessee. And actually, total output is about $53 billion worth of manufactured products in 2016, with there being right over 5,000 actual manufacturing firms in Tennessee, and number of employees has actually gone up. I actually received a number on that yesterday. It's about 347,000 manufacturing employees here in the state of Tennessee, which makes up about 11.4% of Tennessee's workforce. And then I did list the top 10 manufacturing sectors, motor vehicles and parts. We think of our bigger auto manufacturers, Nissan, Volkswagen are both here, but there's actually 920 companies that supply parts to those auto manufacturers that are right here in Tennessee. And again, while many of those are large employers, the majority of those companies are your smaller employers. Exports are also a really big deal. And the total manufactured goods exported was right over $30 billion for 2016. Our export market partners are Canada, Mexico, China, Japan, and Belgium. And then the countries that we did business with in the free trade agreement, who are free I just listed again, this is pretty much in line with the nationwide exports. But here in Tennessee, transportation equipment, computer and electronic products, chemicals, miscellaneous products, and machinery, and the total value again is $33 billion. And while we're exporting again here in Tennessee, we're also seeing a significant amount of foreign investment. And here I've just listed the top foreign direct investment countries in Tennessee based on the number of companies across the state. So in Japan, we have, or Japan has 186 manufacturing firms in Tennessee, and has invested $17.8 billion, followed by Germany with 106 firms, an investment of $5.5 billion, Canada, 74 companies with about $2 billion, and the UK has 110 companies with about $1.5 billion worth of investment.
So is this a direct investment in manufacturing or just in business in general?
Manufacturing.
And so for instance, if all of that is in Tennessee, what manufacturing industries are primarily represented, let's just say, by Japan, who has the largest amount of investment? Do they provide that information?
I do, and in a couple of slides, I have some of the biggest. I have some of the biggest, it's not the next slide, but it's the one right after that where I've listed some of those top employers and the number of employees they have and what they've been invested. And this is just the number of jobs for those same, a lot of the same countries and what they provide, about 50,000 jobs from Japan, Germany, France, UK are all big players in employment. And then this is the slide where I did name the company. Underneath that, you can see the country, the FDI country. And I do have also, I thought I had a number of, I do have the number of employees at each of those companies, but those are just some of the countries represented as major FDI employers. So here, of course, Volkswagen, Gustav would be another one here. I don't see it listed on here. Oh, Pilgrim's Pride would be another Hamilton County investor. And reason for, so why is there such a large amount of FDI investment in Tennessee and even the Chattanooga region? Central location, easy access by road, air, and rail. Again, like I said, there are eight major interstates in Tennessee, with six commercial airports and six Class 1 railroads. So making sure that manufacturers can receive supplies and then also be able to ship out the products that they manufacture is really, really crucial, and not something that, even as I go further out of Hamilton County into more rural communities, transportation becomes more and more challenging, whether it's mountains, utilities, making sure that utilities are available for manufacturers to have access to is something that's not already established and has to be played out, and economic development plays a key role in making sure if there's a piece of land available that is equipped with what's needed. Here in the Chattanooga region, foreign direct investment is definitely being driven by the automotive sector. Volkswagen announced today that they will be manufacturing another SUV here in Chattanooga, and I think, I don't even want to quote the number of that investment, but I think it was in the realm of $350 million more that they'll be investing to do so. There's 920 auto suppliers across the state of Tennessee, and 120 of those are foreign owned as well. Other international companies that have located to Tennessee, LG Electronics from South Korea, they recently invested $250 million in Clarksville, Tennessee. And a site I visited not too long ago with our neighboring county of Ray County, is Nokian Tires, which they are from Finland, and invested $360 million in their site and plan to employ about 400 people at that location. And their plant will have the ability to produce 4 million tires per year there. So those were a couple of other ones. So as I talk about expansion and investment and all of those things, again, as I sit and meet with industry, and ask them what keeps you up at night or what is your biggest priority as an employer in the state of Tennessee, 9 times out of 10, again, it is workforce development and I want to make sure that it's something that I'm staying on the forefront of. So this just shows, this is a lot of data for a slide, and normally I would not put that much information on one slide, but I thought it was all really relevant. The National Association of Manufacturers and the Manufacturing Institute issued a survey across just the public sector, not specific to manufacturing, of what's the public's perception of manufacturing. So just some highlight takeaways from that is that 83% of Americans surveyed believe that manufacturing is really important to the U.S. prosperity. And 7 out of 10 people even believe that the United States should invest more in manufacturing. 8 out of 10 Americans believe manufacturing is important to American standard of living, and 64% have a perception that the industry is high-tech and very technology-influenced. But then if you go over here, 1 in every 3 Americans surveyed said they would not encourage their children to pursue a career in manufacturing. 77% say they worry about the security and stability of careers in manufacturing. 70% do not see manufacturing as a strong career path, and 64% are pretty skeptical about just the overall wages and benefits with a career in manufacturing. 60% of those see manufacturing jobs as interesting and rewarding, but only half believe that it pays well in comparison to jobs in other industries. And so manufacturing executives and everyone who's working to just change the perception of manufacturing and make sure that there's an exposure of industry to the public, to students, to teachers, just to other industries that work with manufacturing, do you think this is something that can change? And the ways that we see that changing are through internships and apprenticeship programs. That was what 67% of the people voted that were surveyed, and then 62% think manufacturing certifications and degrees. And that's something that Chattanooga has definitely taken, I think, a leadership stance on in terms of across the country. As I go to workforce development conferences and things like that, while we do have a skills gap here, I think that Chattanooga, in comparison to other parts of the country, is being really, really proactive, and it's really cool to see all the different initiatives across the region. So why is this important? Over the next decade, we're expected to see about 3.5 million jobs needed in manufacturing. And because of the skills gap, about 2 million of those are seen to go unfilled. And why are there 3.5 million manufacturing jobs that are suddenly going to be open? About 2.7 million baby boomers are estimated to retire. And then about 7,000 new manufacturing jobs are going to be created from economic expansion. So just again, it's a lot of data for one slide, but 84% of executives in manufacturing do agree there's a talent shortage. About 80% of those said they would be willing to pay more if they could find the qualified and skilled workers that they need. Currently, it takes about 90 days to hire highly skilled workers for specific jobs. And then about 6 out of 10 jobs are open in production positions due to not having the qualifications needed. And just to give you kind of not a super recent statistic, but an alarming statistic, is that in 2011, about 600,000 jobs did go unfilled due to the skills gap. So current workforce development strategies that companies are currently going to our internal employee training of existing employees and professional development initiatives surrounding employees they already have, working with local schools and community colleges, external training and certification programs, and then a lot of companies are also working with veterans associations to plug in veterans to roles in manufacturing as they come back from serving, providing opportunities for them. Skills that companies think that employees are missing are computer skills, problem solving, technical training, and math are the top 4 categories that they ranked as skills that are needed. And then the survey also noted that 82% of manufacturers believe that the skills because you do have to have the workers to do all those things. So what are we doing here in Tennessee and in the Chattanooga area to kind of combat that problem? Governor Haslam took a huge initiative and created what we call Drive to 55, which was his initiative that to make sure that by 2025, 55% of all Tennesseans have a college degree or certificate. And then there's three tiers in which that falls under. So Tennessee Promise is where high school students in the state of Tennessee can receive 2 years of tuition-free college at community or technical, the TCATs. And part of that is through scholarship and maintaining, I think it's a 2.0 GPA, but also a mentorship program. So community advocates and leaders are mentoring students through through that process, and then they also have to complete 8 hours of community service. And Tennessee Reconnect is where I see a lot of industry engaging. It's for adult students to return to finish a degree, or maybe someone who's working in industry that wants to go to college for the first time, or resources for veterans and service members. And the goals there are just for them to either obtain new skills, advance within the workplace, and obtain new skills to let them do other positions within their existing employer, or maybe complete college for the first time. And then lastly, Tennessee LEAP, which stands for Labor Education Alliance Program, again, partners industry with education to make sure that we're students are graduating from technical programs or receiving certifications, and they're ready to go straight into work in a manufacturing environment or whatever certification program that they choose. And that, again, falls in line with the work we're doing with Hope Street Group, where we're going to establish industry partners that are willing to have work-based learning inside their facility. So they're okay with having high school students maybe working in their manufacturing facility in the morning or afternoon while also getting dual credit for college courses. One last video just to kind of provide an overview of what the future of manufacturing looks like.
You're manufacturing an actual good and you have a skill to do that. That's something that will always be needed. People will always need to have something manufactured for them of some real world good. So there's solace in knowing that your career has a future.
It's kind of amazing that we get rolls of sheet metal that come off of a trailer, and at the end of the line, somebody puts a key in and it starts. All of these things have to come together perfectly, and it does.
The work that I'm doing is right on the cutting edge of innovation in the industry. We're doing new cloud-based service technology, new types of analytics that really haven't been done in the industry before.
It really makes you feel good to come to work every day and feel like you're making a difference in what you're doing.
But there's a lot of beauty in how something is made.
I was one of two women in my computer science class of 200, and it felt like I was an outlier. Now, more than half of my team are women.
We're all really proud to be women in this career.
To think like a digital native, go into manufacturing and use that skill set is tremendous.
It's in their blood, you know, it's their life to make something.
What you're doing actually has an impact on the world.
Blind ad, so I had no idea that I was applying for a job within the manufacturing. job. I was like, I can try it out and see if I like it. And I just love the, she asked me too, like what I love the most about my job. And it's just the diversity of working with not only manufacturers, but all the different types of manufacturers. And then just all the companies that play a role in manufacturing. So education, any suppliers of manufacturing, all of your banks, law firms, healthcare, government agencies, all play just a really huge role in manufacturing. And we all, accounting firms are somebody we work with all the time. So that's, yeah, it wasn't a clear, I want to enter into manufacturing path at all.
Yeah, do you guys primarily derive your revenue from membership dues?
Yeah, I'd say 80-85% of our revenue is strictly based upon membership dues, so membership is crucial. So we have a lot of long, and that's something we haven't ever really had a huge focus on is membership recruitment, word of mouth. I guess Chattanooga is a very kind of close-knit community, so if you're a manufacturer and you're a member of our association, you're quick to tell your vendors, your suppliers, your law firm, your accounting firm, and so we get a lot of business that way. And then the remainder of our revenue comes from, we do have a lot of events and programs. So we have an annual golf tournament for our membership, which has a little bit of revenue. And then we have a few other bigger events. And then most of our smaller events aren't revenue-based.
Is membership growing at a similar rate that manufacturing is growing? Do you see that? Or do you guys still feel like you have a lot of room to grow as far as recruiting?
We have a ton of room to grow as far as recruiting. I've only been in this role, a year in June. So membership is something that I definitely see as has a huge potential to grow. And definitely having a regional focus. I didn't talk about this in my presentation because it's kind of complicated and confusing, but we were serving as a statewide association for a little bit. And we decided it's just best to focus our efforts here regionally. And so now that we have a clear vision of that's what we're planning to do, I definitely see growing membership in the surrounding region.
Bring your A game. So thank you, Ms. King, for being here.